So I think automotive is going through, I think, once in a lifetime transformation, because I think this is actually a point in time where transportation as a business is changing. There are so many inflection points that are upon us. First of all, the car industry, as it gets connected to the cloud, as every single asset gets connected to the cloud, this brings about a completely different way of thinking about how do you monetize, how do you view, how do you plan for transportation out in the future. There are many different elements to this opportunity. I think the first one is, what is the passenger vehicle going to look like in the future? Is this going to be something that we're going to purchase as an asset? Is it something we're going to lease? Something that we're going to use opportunistically? Many different business models that have been discussed, but the car architecture, as it evolves towards something that is heavily software-based, is going to allow these new business models to be able to thrive and actually get accelerated. Imagine a situation where you can actually control through software the identity, the personalization of the vehicle that you want to use for a day, a week, a year. Imagine that you are a business who would like to get access to delivery vehicles that are customized for your specific business. All of those things, all of this is possible if the car architectures were reimagined to be heavily software-centric, and then the vehicle itself was evolved to be able to go support these architectures. A lot of this is possible because you have the convergence of high-performance semiconductors, advanced software, and cloud connectivity. As all of this comes together, you are able to create these new experiences, these new opportunities for the vehicle. So that is something that we are right in the middle of. You know, we have the good fortune of having been in the automotive business now for over 20 years. We've been supplying wireless connectivity to cars since 2002. We work with every single automaker. We expanded our business about 8 years ago to get into the cockpit business, which has become very relevant for every automaker because it represents the brand identity of the automaker inside the vehicle, which is something that every automaker is very keen to make sure that they have full control over. And as you think about these opportunities that I talked about, it really puts us, it gives us a seat at the table where we are able to reimagine along with our tier one and our automaker partners, as well as a variety of new partners from the ecosystem. What are the changes needed in the reimagination of the car architecture? So this is really, in my mind, it's fascinating because we will actually see a significant change over the next decade across the transportation business. The other piece that I would touch upon is infrastructure. If you think about the way infrastructure is designed today, and what is needed for the next generation vehicle, you know, safety comes to mind. How do you make roads safer? How do cars and roads interact much more closely with each other? All of that requires a rethink of what the next generation infrastructure looks like. How can it make our roadways safer, focus on reducing fatalities? And again, you know, tied back to technology in the vehicle, brings about 5G, brings about V2X. So, you know, frankly, this is a space ripe with opportunity, and for a company like Qualcomm, you know, we are technologists, we are systems companies. So really fascinating space for us to be in, and we consider ourselves very fortunate to have this, you know, to be part of this ecosystem at this point in time. So, you know, the way that I think about really any connectivity technology, you know, Qualcomm has been one of the pioneers of wireless technology, mass wireless technology for many decades. And every time we think about technology, the part that is very important is to understand how pervasive it will be, especially from the perspective nowadays of how many different use cases, how many different endpoints can it serve. If you thought about 4G, 4G was about bringing broadband into your palm, bringing, you know, making your smartphone something that was going to be able to make your experience change. And the whole transition from PCs to smartphones was able to happen because you had a high-speed wireless connection. With 5G, the same is going to happen, but for the larger Internet of Things, it has started to happen. If you think about the car, and it's not really just the car, if you think about transportation at large, what is needed is to be able to rely on real-time, low-latency information, real-time, high-bandwidth services in a mobile environment, where that mobile environment is not necessarily a human, but a thing, but an asset, but an object. And that's what 5G is making happen and will continue to make happen over the coming decade. And let me give you some examples. Every customer that we are engaged with today is building a vehicle that will have wireless connectivity in it. When they build wireless connectivity in the car, the obvious question is, what is the, quote unquote, killer use case? There is no one killer use case. There are actually many, many killer use cases. But because the car is becoming this, this software machine on wheels, the whole idea of the car having access to real-time software updates, security updates, if there are vulnerabilities, if there is a cybersecurity concern, all of these things require the automaker to be able to go update their asset, manage it. When you think about this in the context of rolling this out globally, that poses a significant burden on the network operators. They want to be able to make sure that such transactions are happening over the most efficient link. Over the next decade, 5G is going to be that link. The other major advantage that I think 5G is going to bring is the low latency aspect of 5G. Over time, as wireless technologies have progressed, latency translates directly into user experience. So you can run a lot of different applications based upon what kind of latency the underlying transport affords you. And if you think about the car, where a real-time map that is providing you real-time traffic updates is a low-latency application. If you make that map something that exists within an automated vehicle, within a vehicle that has a traffic jam assist application that is running, that is driving you on the freeway, having real-time information about what is up ahead 2 miles from where you are is extremely important. Again, a major use case for 5G. So the other big area that we have focused on over the last 5 years is V2X. And one thing that is very unique about V2X is that this isn't really an application that is very relevant in the smartphone space or in the mobile ecosystem. This is a vehicle application, it's a transportation application. And when we started to look at this in the early days, the assumption was, you need every car to have this, and then you need to get to network effects. And once you have network effects, you will start to then get the benefit, but that's a long time away. What we are now seeing, and China embraced cellular V2X about 2 years ago, is in the process of deploying it, making it a mass market application. Every car has to have cellular V2X. The use cases that we are seeing are actually extremely compelling. Next generation highways are being designed such that roadside units are intelligent. They have cameras, they have sensors, they have the ability to be connected to the cloud, but also broadcast via cellular V2X hyper-local information about what is going on in that environment, within the next 500 meters, within the next mile. And this is actually a safety application. So if you are, driving down the freeway at 65 miles an hour and there is a traffic jam up ahead, there is a car pileup, and your car and you as a driver had information available to you because the highway was intelligent enough to provide you that information, it will certainly save lives. It will certainly reduce accidents. So to me, this whole confluence of making infrastructure more intelligent using technology, if you apply V2X as one of those technology tools that allows you to go do that, I think it's just, it will actually have a very predictable, very measurable improvement in really the safety of vehicles, the safety of the environment that we are in. So we look at 5G really as advancement in wireless technology to be able to keep up with a lot of change that is happening around us, but most importantly, how does the car as it becomes more intelligent, take advantage of the faster wireless technology? And how does infrastructure, as it becomes smarter, deploy this technology to make our environment safer? You know, I wish we were doing this live as opposed to over a virtual session. But you know, I think the way that we think about such symposiums, and this is one we are honored to be a part of. You know, automotive and transportation are complex industries, and they are going through a tremendous amount of change across the board, all at the same time. And really, the only way to be able to have a 360-degree view of what is needed over the coming years is to be very actively present in ecosystems that deeply understand what the key considerations and implications are of technology intersecting with you know, the next generation automobile or transportation products that we build. And so from that perspective, you know, for us, things like communications are extremely important because we are a communications company at heart. We have been part of many, many ecosystems, continue to be. So this is definitely a very important ecosystem for us to be a part of. And then frankly, we learn a lot about what the vision of our partners, of our customers, of our ecosystem is as we participate in this type of an event. So you know, for us, it's very important to be closely associated with this symposium, and we appreciate being invited to that.